Isolation that Brazil had felt barely 2 months earlier. On Sunday, May the 1st, at Imola, the country's greatest hero, Ayrton Senna, had been killed in a crash while leading the Formula One San Marino Grand Prix. If ever a country has known sporting joy and sporting despair, it's been Brazil in 1994.
I just saw him plunge off to the right. What on earth happened there?
Ce week-end, on a vécu une véritable tragédie.
Ayrton Senna has been killed in the San Marino Grand Prix. San Marino Grand Prix was undoubtedly Formula One's blackest weekend. Not only the death of Ayrton Senna, but when Roland Ratzenberger was killed in qualifying, it was the first fatality at a Grand Prix for 12 years. Four times world champion Alain Prost was Senna's greatest rival in the late 80s, and at times, not his greatest admirer. But their relationship had mellowed in recent times, and Alain Prost was anxious to pay this tribute to Ayrton Senna.
First of all, I want to eliminate all the bad moments we had together, because at the end of last year we have tried to forget everything bad, and we made peace, if you can call that this way, and he wanted to be more and more close to me, and everything I've done in the past was with him. In the last 10 years we fight together, and when you talk about Senna, you talk about Prost, when you talk about Prost, you talk about Senna. And I want to remember that. I want to remember the good memories we had together. He was an exceptional driver, and I just want to remember him as a possible friend, but as especially the best driver I've never seen in my career.
After Imola, the Grand Prix world reassembled in somber mood at Monaco. The sport had to go on, but without its greatest star. Michael Schumacher and Benetton looked unstoppable. The German won the first four Grand Prix. Damon Hill was now heading a Williams team that had the task of regrouping after the loss of Senna. 4 weeks after Imola, they were back to their best in Spain.
Damon Hill wins!
An important part of the recovery was complete, and after his enforced promotion from test driver, David Coulthard's progress was also encouraging. Potential made way for experience in France, and Mansell would take Coulthard's seat in the last three Grand Prix as well. In the 3 months that followed Imola, emergency rule changes attempted to make the sport slower and safer, but Schumacher was still the quickest. Unfortunately, he was also quickest away in the parade lap at Silverstone. Damon Hill had qualified on pole. Schumacher's overtaking was illegal. Schumacher led the British Grand Prix, but we'd arrived at the turning point in the season.
Schumacher is going to be black flagged.
Schumacher drove past the black flag. Benetton protested, but the inevitable disqualification at last gave a home Grand Prix victory to the Hill family.
Damon Hill wins the British Grand Prix. Magnificent.
Damon sends his critics into retreat while Schumacher is under attack. Hanging over him now was a two-race ban for what happened at Silverstone. He wasn't short of support at Hockenheim, but failed to finish a German Grand Prix that saw near disaster for his Benetton team. The team had removed a filter from the refueling equipment. In the pits was Jos Verstappen. Only the dynamic reactions of the pit crew prevented a tragedy from which Formula One might not have recovered. Instead, Verstappen had only minor burns. And the day ended with a welcome victory, the first for Ferrari in 4 years. Schumacher then delivered victory in Hungary, and so it seemed, at Spa.
The stewards decided to inflict a penalty on the driver Michael Schumacher of exclusion from the event.
The compulsory wooden skid block under his car had worn too thin. His patience was going the same way. As Schumacher served his ban, Damon Hill held his nerve. He had to win in Italy and Portugal, and he did. Schumacher's lead, which was 37 points before Silverstone, was now down to one. At Jerez, Schumacher won from Hill, but in appalling conditions in Japan, Damon produced one of his bravest ever drives. At Suzuka, Hill won from Schumacher.
Damon Hill wins the Japanese Grand Prix!
Both men had proved themselves worthy of the world title, and it will be decided at the final round in Adelaide. For 36 laps, the two drivers produced a thriller, Schumacher in front, but unable to shake off the Williams. Then came the final twist to a season of controversy.
Oh, out goes Schumacher, and Damon Hill only has to keep going to be world champion of 1994, but can he keep going?
Hill never had a chance of continuing in a car damaged by Schumacher's errant Benetton. As many in the sport cried foul, the new champion felt a quiet celebration was most diplomatic. Then, just as we thought the season was all over,
Nigel Mansell wins in Australia!
And he intends to make a full-time Formula One return next season, possibly alongside Damon Hill at Williams, whose ability and resolve has matured during this extraordinary season. He sportingly refused to pursue the Adelaide issue, despite the evidence, but clearly when you've given so much and come so close, it hurts. Damon, if what happened in Adelaide had been followed by protest and by punishment, and you were sitting here as world champion, what sort of satisfaction would you have got from that?
do you mind if I don't comment? It's a very, very difficult one. Motor racing is often has incidents like that, and the governing body and the stewards of the meeting are really the people who should sort that out.
What sort of rivalry has developed between you and Michael Schumacher during the course of the season?
Well, I'm not happy about it. I'd like to beat him next year.
And you've got every chance of beating him next year, of course. Looking back on this last year, how tough was it for the team to regroup after the events of the San Marino Grand Prix?
It was very tough, and it's not easy to appreciate how difficult it is for particularly the members of the team at Williams and for the whole of Formula One to have carried on after such a dreadful weekend.
And the drives that gave you most satisfaction, terrific victory at Silverstone and wonderful in Japan as well. Which gave you the most satisfaction out of those?
Well, I think that I was happy. My driving in Japan I was very happy with, but the British Grand Prix for me was the most satisfying victory simply because it's on your home turf and you can't beat a victory at home.
Have you got any idea who's going to be your teammate for next year?
No, I honestly haven't got a clue, no.
All right, well, let's talk to your teammate for this year. David Coulthard, as I understand it, you've sort of signed for both Williams and McLaren, which must rate as good tactics for any aspiring young driver, I would have thought. When's it all going to be sorted out?
Well, hopefully in the next couple of weeks, certainly before Christmas, we'll know exactly where my future lies.
But here you are with two top teams fighting over you. It says a lot for what you've achieved this year.
Well, you know, in some respects you'd say it was a desirable situation, but from my first year in Formula One, I think I'd much rather have a clear-cut situation as to where I was going to be driving next year.
Wherever you go, you're in a great position for next year. David Coulthard and the World Championship runner-up, Damon Hill.
We're very close now to the moment when we can announce who will be the BBC Sports Personality for 1994. But first, a brief reminder of the leading contenders. Thank you. now to announce the top three in the voting for this year's sports personality. Please welcome back that very first winner in 1954, Mr. Chris Chataway.
I was lucky enough to win this a long time ago. But I do remember that I lost an awful lot of races too. So I'd like to say one word for the thousands of men and women who don't figure in any of these lists, but who in 1994 scaled some personal sporting peak. There are a few lines of Longfellow that have always seemed to me to say it well for sport at any level. Not in the clamour of the crowded street, not in the shouts and plaudits of the throng, but in ourselves are triumph and defeat. But now, for the plaudits of the throng, me included, the result of the BBC Sports Personality for 1994 is in third place, European and Commonwealth champion over high hurdles, also the reigning world record holder, and unbeaten in 1994, Colin Jackson. And Colin, as we know, is not here, but in Atlanta. And so you will be, we shall keep your award here carefully for you and hand it to you when you come back. Well done.
Thank you.
In second, this country's most successful female athlete ever. In 1994, she became the first woman to complete the Grand Slam of major titles and led the British women to their first ever World Cup appearance, Sally Gunnell. And in first place, the viewer's choice for BBC Television's Sports Personality of the Year for 1994, someone who won six Formula One races, including a memorable triumph in the British Grand Prix, completing a full family set. In only his second full year, this man came agonizingly close to emulating his father as world champion. 1994 was the year he earned recognition as one of the elite performers in his sport, Damon Hill.
Thank you very much. I think if you were to get 3 or 4 million people out of bed at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning on a Sunday morning, two weekends on the trot, you'd hardly expect them to vote for you to win an award. But that's what happened, I think. And so I'd like to say thank you very much indeed to all those people who have voted for me for this award. It's a very, very prestigious award, and any sportsman would have to be extremely, extremely proud to receive it, which I am. I'd have to say also that this season, it would be completely amiss for me not to say that my season was immeasurably influenced by the loss of my teammate, Ayrton Senna, and it's with that in mind that I receive any award like this year. Thank you very much.
The BBC Television Sports Personality for 1994 is Damon Hill.